believes that Jesus does have the power to break every chain. I believe it. I have seen it. I have actually, as I get myself set here and ready, I have seen a chain that was broken this morning already. I just want to thank my brother Kyle for teaching Bible study today, Sunday school. There was a time where I think that many people might not have thought that could be the case. But I'll tell you something, God can, God will, Jesus will break every chain. God did. He has done that, and it is a blessing to me, even more so of a blessing for me personally today, is that as I turned my scriptures in today to sound for them to put up here for you guys, as soon as Kyle said he could not get away from teaching on something that the Lord kept putting on his heart that he was supposed to teach this, and it was, the verses were in my notes that I gave them. So those of you that were here for Sunday school might be a little redundant, which tells me that you need to hear it. Maybe you didn't hear it after the first time, but you're going to hear it this time, hopefully. I pray that the word going forth today falls on fertile ground. That's my hope. That's my prayer for you today. I pray today that if there be any rocks in the way that are keeping the word from taking root today in your hearts, I pray that those rocks would be removed. Right? I pray right now, if there are thorns in the way that are choking out the word as soon as you hear it, I pray that those cares of this world would go away for right now, that the word would go forth. I pray that if somebody has been stepping on your heart because there's no boundaries and there's a pathway there that the word is having a hard time taking root, I pray right now that the Lord put those boundaries up now and create a fertile ground on your heart that the word would take root. That's my prayer for you today. My prayer for me today is that I get out of God's way, right? I want to get out of God's way. I want him to speak through me. I think that when he puts something on our hearts to speak to you up here, there are a lot of things that go through your mind, and you have to be very deliberate about getting out of the way. And so today, I want you guys to pray for me that I would get out of the way, that you would hear what the Lord has for you, not what Mandy might be saying, but what the Lord is saying through an obedient servant. I will tell you that this is a difficult task to get up here when your pastor has been doing this for 30 years. And when he trusts you with this, there's due diligence that comes in play there. Where I have to take this serious. I have to take the word of God serious. He takes it serious every week when he comes up here, when Sister Shelley teaches. Kyle knows the weight of this. Bucky knows the weight of this. There's a few that have come up here and know the weight of bringing the word to you. And so I want you to know that I have prayerfully sought the Lord and what he wants me to say to you today. And this is where I am. So we're going to start in Matthew 13, and this is going to be verse 24 through 30. And I don't typically read out of the King James because I'm not real good at that. And sometimes I trip over the these and thous, unlike my husband, who one day, I think we've probably been married for maybe 15 years at this point, and one day he come out of the bedroom quoting Shakespeare. And I said, what? He's like saying this big, long thing. And I said, I didn't even know that was in there. Well, there it was. So he does very well with the King James. I don't do so well with it. So I want you guys to just be patient with me while I do that. I am going to stop my iPad from going off on me here too, so that never. I said it to never. All right, I said it to never. Don't go off on me. Okay, Matthew 13, and this is starting in verse 24. The kingdom of heaven is likened unto a man which sowed good seed in his field. But while men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. But when the blade was sprung up and brought forth fruit, then appeared the tares also. So the servant of the householder came and said unto him, Sir, did thou not thou sow good seed in thy field? From whence then hath it tares? And he said unto them, An enemy has done this. The servant said unto him, Wilt thou then that we go and gather them up? But he said, Nay, lest while you gather up the tares, you root up also the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. And in the time of harvest, I will say to the reapers, Gather ye together first the tares, and bind them in bundles and burn them. But gather the wheat into my barn. Oh, Lord, help me today. Help me today. I want to go back up to verse 25 really quickly here. And I want to talk about the fact that it says that the men were sleeping. The men were sleeping. The enemy was able to come in and do what he did because the men were sleeping. Men, are you awake today? At Crossroads Chapel, are you awake today, men? Yeah. Let's keep the enemy from sowing the tares among the wheat. But you got to be awake. You got to be vigilant. That's what Peter says, right? He says, be sober. How many men in the house are sober? Be sober. Be vigilant. Because your enemy, the adversary, the devil, Satan, call him what you want, but he wants to sow tares among the wheat. And if you're asleep, he will. And then he'll go about his way. You won't even know that he did it. You know what caused them? I love this parable. I love this because you know what caused them to understand and recognize that there were tares? But when the blade was sprung up and brought forth fruit, then appeared the tares also. Your fruit will expose the tares. Your fruit will expose the tares. Kyle, fruit is important. Your fruit is important. How do you know if there's tares? Well, your fruit will expose it. That's what happened here. The fruit exposed the tares. You guys ever hear that song by Casting Crowns? You guys know this song, While You Were Sleeping? Do you guys know this song? It's a very old song. Just bear with me for just a second because I want you guys to I want you to hear the lyrics to this song. I'm just going to read through them very quickly. It says, O little town of Bethlehem, looks like another silent night. Above your deep and dreamless sleep, a giant star lights up the sky. And while you're lying in the dark, there shines an everlasting light. For the king has left his throne and is sleeping in a manger tonight. O Bethlehem, what have you missed while you were sleeping? For God became a man and stepped into your world today. O Bethlehem, you'll go down in history as a city that has no room for its king. While you were sleeping, Mary shivers in the cold, trying to keep the Savior warm, born among the animals wrapped in dirty rags because there was no room for him in the world he came to save. O Bethlehem, what have you missed while you were sleeping? For God became a man and stepped into your world today. O Bethlehem, you'll go down in history as a city with no room for its king. United States of America, looks like another silent night, as we're sound asleep by philosophies that save the trees and kill the children. And while we're lying in the dark, there's a shout heard across the eastern sky. For the bridegroom has returned and has carried his bride away in the night. America, what will we miss while we are sleeping? Will Jesus come and leave us slumbering where we lay? America, will we go down in history as a nation with no room for its king? Woo, it's an oldie, but it's good. It's good. Wake up, church. Wake up, church. Wake up, church. Let's check each other's fruit. Let's check and make sure that we are bearing good fruit. The third thing that I want to talk about in this parable, this particular parable, is that they were left. They left them. He said, no, they're going to be there. They're going to be there. Leave them alone. Leave them alone. Leave the tares alone. They're going to be among us. Right? Because if you are so focused on the tares instead of the fruit, you'll miss the fruit. He said, you'll mess up. You'll have to lift up the wheat to get the fruit out, to get the tares out. You'd have to bring up that wheat too. So you have to bring up all of the fruit when you're focused on just the tares. Go with me to Luke 3. Now, as the people were in expectation and all reasoned in their hearts about John, whether he was the Christ or not, John answered, saying to all, I indeed baptize you with water, but one mightier than I is coming, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to loose. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly clean out his threshing floor and gather the wheat into his barn, but the chaff he'll burn with unquenchable fire. You guys know what a winnowing fan is? You guys know what this is? I had to look this up. I didn't know. But this winnowing fan, there's different types of them. And one of them is sort of what, remember when Jesus is telling Peter he wants to sift him. So what would happen is that the wheat and the tares grow up together. And the wheat weighs more. It's heavier. So what happens is they would do this though and throw it up into the air, if you watch this, and then all of the tares fly off and the wheat falls to the threshing floor. But all of the other is blown away, and they would take it and they would wrap it up. And they would say, okay, so this is now, so that's when you're winnowing, you would separate it. Jesus said, John the Baptist here is saying that Jesus is coming to do that. He's going to come and do that. Jesus is doing that. He said he's got his winnowing fan in his hand. He's ready to go. He's coming. He's going to baptize you first. This is the good news. The good news here is he says he's going to baptize you with Holy Spirit and fire. You're not going to be able to do or bear good fruit without the Holy Spirit. It is, in fact, the fruit of the Spirit, right? You have to have the fruit of the Spirit. You have to have the Holy Spirit in order to bear the fruit. You have to. Without the Holy Spirit, I know a lot of people, we've had questions about this. We've discussed this time and time again in private, that if you are not filled with the Holy Spirit, you're powerless. You got to get filled with the Holy Spirit. It matters. It matters. It matters to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Paul says in, I think it's in chapter 19 of Acts, he walks up on a group of people. He says, have you received the Holy Spirit since you've been baptized? And they said, we didn't even know there was. And so Paul laid hands on them, a bunch of them, a group of them, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in tongues and prophesy. And I know that scares a lot of people, but I'm telling you that it's in the Scripture. I'm telling you it's in the Word of God. And so I know there's things in here that can be real scary and that people are afraid to get into the presence of God. We see this really back in the Old Testament. We see this quite a bit with Moses. He takes the tabernacle and he puts the tabernacle right outside. And everybody stays in their tents because they're so afraid to go into the presence of God. They won't. They stay in their tents. And Moses goes and he convenes with God. He communicates with God right there. And they can see that this is happening, but they're so full of fear that they won't step out. I wonder today if there's some of us in here that might be a little bit full of fear, that we're scared to get close to God. Maybe we're scared to get so close to the Holy Spirit. Maybe we're so close to, that we're so scared to get so close because we wonder what God will see. Let me assure you, he's already seen it. He already knows it's there. He already knows it's there. Let him burn that out of you. Let him burn that out of you. That's what he says he wants to do. He said he's going to baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. Let him burn that out of you. Some of us need to be tried by fire. I don't know. That was not in my notes about Moses, but I'll tell you that I do think it matters. I think it matters. Our willingness to get close to God matters. It matters. It matters. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. I'm going to go backwards a little bit in Matthew because my question in this is, how would you know that you're bearing good fruit? How do you know? How do you know? Matthew 7, verse 15. Matthew 7, verse 15. Beware of the false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they're ravenous wolves. You will know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Even so, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a bad tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Therefore, by their fruits, you will know them. Kyle said that this morning. I chuckled in my spirit a little bit thinking, Lord, do you need them to know today? Do you need us to know today that we're going to be known by our fruits? Do you need us to know that today? Because I think the answer to that is yes. As he said those exact words, that's how we're going to be known. And you have to be bearing fruit. You got to check, and we got to check. We got to check with each other. What does the fruit look like? What does the fruit look like? What does fruit look like? What does fruit in my life look like? What does fruit in your life look like? What does it look like? Don't you want to know? Don't you want to know? What does it look like? Because for me, I think, okay, Lord, I want to know. Because it says each one that is in the will of the Father. Like, that's the one. I want to be that. I want to be in the will of the Father. Jen, that's what I want for my life. I want that. I want that. And so I want to know, is there fruit in my life? There's a proverb that says that the power of death and life are in the tongue, and those who love it will eat of its fruit. Those who love it will eat of its fruit. What kind of fruit is coming out? What kind of fruit am I handing off? That's a question I have for myself. It's a question I have for you. What kind of fruit is abundant in your life? What kind of fruit? Are you trying to pick figs from thistles? Are you trying to hand out something fresh from a tree that's not so good? Because it doesn't taste good. That doesn't taste good. And you can look real good on the outside too, but there are plenty of berries that if you know anything about walking around in the woods, that you are not to eat them just because they're pretty. Because they will poison you. Right? And so I just wonder what kind of fruit and how would we know, how could we know what the fruit is supposed to look like? And then I want to say that we end up in Galatians 5. And I want to show you what the fruit doesn't look like first. And then I will show you. And then I'll talk to you about what the fruit actually does look like. Now the works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I also told you in the past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. I just want to stop right there because those are the works of the flesh. And we were talking in between Sunday school and right now. And the question was that somebody asked, well, how would I know? And when you're provoked, do one of these things come out? Because that's what's going to happen. You're going to be tried. What comes out when you're tried? Pastor Scott often talks about a glass of sweet tea. And he said, if there's a glass of sweet tea, if it's filled to the rim and you jar the glass of sweet tea, there's nothing else that's going to come out. It's just going to spill sweet tea because that's what's in it. And so what must I be filled with? What do I need to be filled with so that when I am jarred, none of these come out? We all have a natural default setting. I think that if you asked any addict or anybody that has suffered with addiction, it would take a trigger and they would go right back to what they knew, right? So what kind of triggers? And that's so popular right now. We talk about these triggers, but what is your triggers? What is it? What's it causing you to go back to? What's it bringing up in you? I asked one of my daughters. She said that something was triggering to her. My question is, what is it triggering you to do? What is it triggering you to do? Are any of these coming out? Does it make you want to be drunk so that you don't have to feel that pain anymore? Is it causing you to want to worship something that is not godly? Maybe it's pornography. Maybe that's your default setting. Maybe that's what they're what they're doing is satisfying your flesh. You understand that's what that is. I'm satisfying my flesh by these things. That's what Paul's talking about here. He's talking about all of these things are going to satisfy your flesh. And they're easy to run to because they're evident. They're easy to run to. There's a bar on every corner if you want to get drunk. In fact, every gas station sells alcohol. It's easy. It's easy to go back to those things. But it says in verse 22, it says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. And those who are Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another. So how do you know if you're bearing good fruit? Is love evident in your life? Is there evidence of love in your life? Is there evidence of joy? Are you walking around mopey Eeyore style? Because something happened and you can't get out of your feels? Or is there joy? Is there joy of the Lord? That's where your strength is. Is there peace? Is there peace in your life? Do you have peace? When you go out and drink the next day, you don't have peace. You don't have peace. I know that feeling. That's not peace. That's not peace. And I'm just picking on one. There's many of these that are evident in the flesh, right? Gentleness. We need the Holy Spirit, you guys. We need the Holy Spirit. Jesus says that he is the vine and that we are the branches. If we're to bear fruit, we have to abide in him and him in us. That's how you bear good fruit. You know the good tree? God, Jesus. That's the good tree. That bears good fruit. If you abide in that vine, you will bear good fruit. You can't help it. You can't help it. But it's going to take the Holy Spirit in order for us to do that. In order for us to bear good fruit, we're going to have the Holy Spirit, because me in the flesh, I cannot. My flesh wants to do things that I know are not holy. My flesh wants to do things that I know are not righteous. My mouth wants to say things that I know the Lord does not want me saying. My heart wants to look at some of the people, some of the tares. And I want to say things And I, there's a part of me, and this is just an awful, this is just my flesh. But I'll tell you something. There's some of them, I just hope they get what they deserve. I find myself saying that, and then I hit my knees thanking Jesus that I did not get what I deserved. Be careful how you deal with the tares. Jesus is going to deal with that. Jesus is going to deal with that. And it's not going to be great for them. But there's a part of me that I know that without the Holy Spirit, I am powerless. I am weak and I am powerless without it. I will fall back to whatever default setting is in my flesh that makes my flesh feel good. And that's how it works for me. I'm going to leave you with one last scripture. Scripture's in Galatians, and it's in chapter 6, just one over. It says, "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, that he will also reap." You know, the world believes this, right? They call it karma, right? Yeah, good things happen to good people. Like, that's good. You do good. You put good out there, girl, and you'll get good right back. The world believes that. Yeah. Yeah. Do you know that that a lot of people, there's not, this is in this book that I'm reading right now, it talks about Lifeway Church did a study on 2,000 people that are non-believers, non-Christians. And I would tell you that there are so many of us that are so afraid to share our faith with our friends, right? Because you think in your mind, they don't want to hear it. I don't want to be a Bible thumper. Like, you're not going to say anything. But do you know that 47% of them are very open to the conversation? And 77% of them don't mind you talking about your faith. They don't mind. They don't mind you talking about your faith. 47%, half of the people are actually open to it. They actually want to hear what you have to say. So somehow this idea that we have that we're not supposed to talk to people about our faith, that's a lie from the enemy. That's a tare among the wheat. That's twisted. That's twisted. They do want to hear. They need to hear. You all, there is a desperate, desperate world out there that needs Jesus right now. And it is getting worse by the minute. And they need Jesus. Just like you and I needed Jesus. They need Jesus. And they're open to hearing about Jesus. But they want to hear it with the fruit of the Spirit, right? They want to hear it from the Holy Spirit. They don't want to hear it from your flesh. They want to hear it from the Holy Spirit. You know that there's a scripture in Hebrews that talks about the angels going forth to prepare the way for salvation. It says, don't you know that they're ministering spirits that go forth to prepare the way for salvation? And so what's so beautiful about that scripture for me is that I know if the Lord is prompting me through the Holy Spirit to share Jesus with somebody, those angels have already been there. They have already been there. They have already set the stage and said those ministering spirits have come to prepare the way for salvation. So when all the Holy Spirit prompts me, I know, oh no, I can know in for sure in my spirit that the Lord has already put purpose that. He's already sent his angels. What a beautiful scripture that is. Don't be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever man sows, that he will also reap. For he sows to his flesh, for he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption. But he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. Hallelujah. And let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. Yeah, don't lose heart. Don't lose heart. Not now. Not now. Don't lose hope. Don't lose hope. I mean, I don't mean to go back to it, but I have to. There were times where my friend lost hope for her husband. She was losing hope. And I saw what God could do in somebody's life. I'm sure there were a lot of people that counted my husband out and had lost hope that he was just going to be the way he was forever. I had a younger sister who was found unconscious on the side of the road, overdosed. Two kids rode by on bikes. They saw her. They went home and told their mom, "Mom, there's a lady on the side of the road. I don't know if she's dead or not." Mom called 911. My sister is about to celebrate 15 years sobriety. Yeah. Don't lose hope. Don't lose hope. You got adult children out there right now that are not serving the Lord. Don't lose hope. You got a husband who's not serving the Lord. Don't lose hope. You got a wife that's not serving the Lord. Don't lose hope. You got friends that aren't serving the Lord. Don't lose hope. Bear good fruit. They'll eat it. They'll eat that fruit that you're producing in your life. Those who love it will eat of it. They'll eat that fruit that you're producing. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all. Is that hard for anybody or just me? Just me? It's just me? It's just me? Yeah. It's hard for me to do good for all. Some people I love to do good for. I love it. And they're so kind. And when you give to them, they're so gracious. It's so wonderful. And then there's others that you give to, and it's not that way. And that is harder and harder to give in those circumstances. But that's what he says here, all, not just one, but do good to all. Even those that we know are not doing good and that don't even have the capacity to do good back to us. But then it says here, especially to those who are the household of faith. Us, you and me, Crossroads Chapel. Right here, this family is a blessing to so many of us. This family is a blessing to so many. So many people that don't have family have it here. So many people that do have family have it here. This local church has changed our lives. It's changed our lives. And I'm grateful. I'm grateful for that. I want you guys to stand with me, and we're going to pray, and then you guys can be on your way, but I do hope that the Lord spoke something to you today that you can glean, that you can take hold of, that you might take with you in your heart. Lord, I thank you. I thank you for your word. I thank you for how beautiful it is. I thank you for each and every person that is here today. Lord, as we go forth today, would you just make your word abundant in our lives? That, Lord, that we would walk with purpose. In Jesus' name, amen. Yeah. Was that a woodpecker?